In this series of videos, we're going to be looking at Thomas Carlyle and at John Stuart Mill, two central thinkers in the 19th century. And the first question that you may be asking is, why are we reading these texts? This is supposed to be a literature course, and these texts seem much more like journalism or sociology. And there are actually three reasons why we would be reading these texts. The first one is that Victorian prose is itself a genre, and an important genre in the period. Many writers are writing a lot of prose during this time. In addition to Carlyle and Mill, we have John Newman and Matthew Arnold and a whole series of other people who are writing. Because, remember, that in the 19th century, print journalism was the dominant form of popular media. They didn't have television, they didn't have radio, they certainly didn't have anything like modern digital social media. And so much of the content that we would consume via TV and talk shows, they were consuming via print media. The second reason is that these two writers were both very important writers in the 19th century. And they both represented important ideological movements, but also influenced a tremendous number of writers who came after them. They gave voice to their opinions, but they also influenced the others that followed them. And so, for instance, Carlyle was incredibly influential, not only in England, influencing such important writers as Dickens, but also in America. In fact, Emerson made two separate trips to England just to meet Carlyle, and was very influential in spreading Carlyle's transcendental ideas in America. The third reason is that because they are such important and influential authors, they represent a basic ideological divide that guides an essential conflict in the 19th century, that between Mill as an empirical rationalist and Carlyle as a transcendentalist. John Stuart Mill himself wrote a series of essays on important figures, and two of his complementary essays, or two companion essays that he wrote, were on Jeremy Bentham and Samuel Taylor Coleridge, who he considered the two dominant thinkers of the previous generation. And in his discussion, he talked about Samuel Taylor Coleridge as the conservative author who strives to preserve that which was valuable from the previous generation, strives to keep important ideas that have been proven and tested by time alive. And then on the other hand, Jeremy Bentham represents the attempt to find out what's wrong with existing rules and to correct it, to provide some sort of correction to existing social systems or beliefs. And John Stuart Mill argues that between the two, if one masters both of them, one masters the main thought of the previous generation, and if one can do what both of them did, one would become basically the perfect author. They would both preserve what was valuable from the past, but also critique what was dangerous or harmful in the past and try to correct it and produce a better society. Now, one would argue that implicitly Mill sees himself in this position, both as conservative and radical, representing both sides. My point is that John Stuart Mill and Thomas Carlyle represent similar roles to those which Mill discussed with Bentham and Coleridge. The basis of the ideological divide between these two authors is between Carlyle as a transcendentalist and Mill as an empirical rationalist. Carlyle believes in a mysterious transcendental realm that is not subject to reason and cannot be reduced to a scale of value. He believes in an absolute standard of right or wrong that's based in a transcendental realm and cannot be reasoned to, but only intuited, can only be realized through creativity. Very similar to, for instance, Shelley's argument in defense of poetry, proving, of course, that Carlyle ultimately is a child of Romanticism. As opposed to John Stuart Mill, who was raised by his father James Mill and his father's close friend and mentor, Jeremy Bentham, to believe in an empirical rationalist basis for behavior. Whereas Thomas Carlyle believes that the transcendental realm which shows us truth is accessible only through the intuition, like Shelley and the other romantics. Jeremy Bentham, James Mill, and then John Stuart Mill believe that truth is available only through empirical observation and rational discussion, and that transcendentalist ideas really are just superstition that needs to be discarded and gets in the way of progress. So while Coleridge's idea of right or wrong derives from this transcendental realm, Mill's utilitarian idea of right or wrong comes from observation. What actions produce happiness or alleviate pain in the real world? And that's the guidance to what is morally praiseworthy or morally blameworthy. Now, Carlyle, on the other hand, believes that this utilitarian standard is reducing humans to sensualist, hedonistic monsters. And he attacks this explicitly in Sartor Resartus, his philosophical autobiography cloaked within the philosophy of Diogenes Teufelsdreck, which we'll be looking at later. But he believes that the radical movement, which followed utilitarianism, is disrupting the natural and organic relationships between individuals and the structure of society, and replacing it by an artificial mechanistic structure, which is based upon self-interest and competition instead of sympathy and cooperation, which is established within a natural hierarchy. I recognize that for many people, Carlyle is an acquired taste, and some people never acquire the taste. But at best, he can be quite confusing. And one of the reasons is that, unlike Mill, he avoids traditional prose. Carlyle was raised by his strict Scottish Presbyterian parents to be a Scottish Presbyterian minister, what we would think of as a fundamentalist Bible pounder minister. But although he lost his faith, he never really lost his religion. And so he's really sort of a secular fundamentalist pulpit pounder. And you can hear in his voice, with his capitalizations and his neologisms and his extreme rhetoric, that he really does seem to be lecturing at us from a pulpit. And in fact, in some ways, it's easier to read his text if you read it aloud because you can hear its rhythms. He's also confusing because he makes many, many, many topical references, which his contemporaries would recognize, but which are lost on us. And it was one of his ways of connecting with his audience, because he was able to refer to things like a contemporary talk show host might, that his audience would also be familiar with, and which would sort of bind them together. But nevertheless, one of the things that makes him so confusing to us, both his use of language and his extreme rhetoric, was what made him so attractive to the 19th century, who was looking for some sort of leader to follow. And what many people find is that if you're uncertain, listen to someone who sounds certain. And Carlyle was able to use that force of character to derive a great deal of influence over his contemporaries. We're going to start off by looking at Thomas Carlyle, and we'll be looking at his essay Characteristics, which he wrote at the same time he was writing Sartor Resartus. And one of the reasons we're looking at it is because it, number one, is much more approachable. But number two, once one understands Characteristics, one really has a good grasp of all of Carlyle and makes it easier to understand the rest of his text, because basically all of Carlyle is carried within the essay Characteristics. What Mill and Carlyle both have in common is they're both social reformers. They see a contemporary society riven with discord and trouble and problems like poverty and illness and rampant industrialism that has no control over it. And they're both looking for ways to correct the problems of that society. But the kinds of problems that they're looking at are directly opposed to one another. On the one hand, Thomas Carlyle is a transcendentalist. He believes that the troubles of his society come from exactly the kinds of rationalistic belief systems that Mill proposes. He's opposed to mechanical, rational, social theories, which he believes, directing his attack directly at utilitarians, are taking us away from an organic connection to truth and enduring rules of behavior. On the other hand, then, of course, we have John Stuart Mill, who's the empiricist and believes that the troubles of society come from following outdated superstitions which permeate social institutions and prevent the correction of society's ills. Modern readers often find Thomas Carlyle extremely confusing, and there are several reasons for that, some of which I can help with, some of which are beyond anyone's help. The first reason is that he makes numerous references throughout his works to popular or common topics of the time,
which would work for Victorian readers but are lost on us because we no longer have that popular knowledge to draw from. Another reason is that he makes a lot of references to foreign languages, German particularly. He's very well read in German idealistic philosophy and often uses German words in English. Both of these problems can be remedied by careful reference to the footnotes at the bottom of the page. But there are also several essential concepts that permeate Carlyle's texts. And if you have a grasp of those concepts, it makes it easier to understand what's going on. So the first concept that we would look at here is this notion of vitalism, which we briefly touched on before. The idea that there is some force or power underlying or transcending the physical universe, which manifests itself in the universe. And when we ignore that power, society becomes mechanistic or dead. This vital or dynamic power must be manifested into society for society to be functional. In this concept, by the way, you should hear an echo of Shelley in his defense of poetry in the notion that this transcendent realm shines through into our world through the influence of poets. Remember that Shelley classifies poets as anyone who manifests this order, including not only artists, but also legislators and architects and anyone else who brings this transcendental order into our contemporary reality. Vitalism is the concept that there is some sort of power energy permeating the universe, which must be manifested in our society through creative people. Now, we'll talk a little bit more in detail later about what kinds of people Carlyle sees as the creative people who manifest this order. But the problem is conflict between a vital and dynamic society and a dead mechanistic society. The second concept that comes up, especially in Sartor Resartus, is this notion of anti-self-consciousness, which, by the way, Mill recognizes in his autobiography, which is this concept of renunciation, or as Carlyle calls it in Sartor Resartus, Entsagen. Anti-self-consciousness depends upon the idea, as discussed in Characteristics, of not continually walking around worrying about how one feels and what one is doing, and reflecting always on one's mental state. And renunciation, or Entsagen, is Carlyle's response to what he sees as the problem of utilitarianism, which is focusing always upon one's own self-interest and one's happiness, which results in the fact that we're continually unhappy because we're always worrying about what it will take to make us happy. In Sartor Resartus, in a passage we will look at in some detail, he talks about the fact that we value our own happiness and our own deserts too highly, and that we're unhappy because we expect too much. And if we renounce any expectation of happiness, then we can be happy with almost anything.
Or even with almost nothing.
Which, by the way, is somewhat similar to Mill's philosophy, as Mill himself recognizes in his autobiography. One of Carlyle's most famous concepts is his concept of the close philosophy. And in fact, Sartor Resartus is supposed to be, its editor introduces it as, an introduction of Diogenes Teufelsdreck's clothes philosophy. In Sartor Resartus, which translates from Latin as the tailor retailored, and Diogenes Teufelsdreck is the tailor whose work is being stitched together, metaphorically, by this editor who is writing Sartor Resartus. Carlyle is laying out the doctrine of the clothes philosophy. Now, it sounds somewhat silly, but in fact, clothes are an interesting metaphorical concept.
Obviously, we wear clothes to protect us from the elements, and also to satisfy cultural expectations of modesty and concealment. But we also select clothes which reveal things about our personality. We use clothing as a way of manifesting to other people how we want them to see us. And even those people who purport not to care about clothing, still, even in the choice to wear sweats that they bought at Walmart all the time, are still telling other people that they don't care about clothing. Even clothes that aren't meant to be symbolic, nevertheless, symbolize something to other people within a society.
In Sartor Resartus, Carlyle is examining this metaphor of the clothes philosophy through the person of Diogenes Teufelsdreck, who is his alter ego and spokesman. According to Carlyle, clothes are the outward manifestation of something that's hidden.
In the same way that clothes can reveal our personalities while they hide our bodies.
And he even goes on to talk about language as the clothing of thought. Language is the outward manifestation of those thoughts which are hidden inside of us. And so it becomes in some way, for Carlyle, who believes in this transcendental realm, a manifestation of the transcendental world into our actual world. So clothing in this case becomes an analogy for the way that the transcendental world manifests itself in our experience. But according to Carlyle, clothing also wears out. Obviously, in the real world, clothing wears out. But that clothing that we create in the real world to manifest transcendental ideology also wears out. One example of this for Carlyle is what he thinks of as traditional religion. He believes that traditional religion was once a manifestation of the transcendental world into our world and represented the values of this transcendental world, but it has become worn out, and he calls Christian religion Hebrew old clothes. And the problem is that people continue to try to wear these clothes which are worn out and no longer effectively represent the values of the transcendental world. But we haven't yet adopted new clothing. We don't yet have new clothing to replace the worn out old clothing. So people are still walking around in clothing that no longer serves its function. It no longer expresses the transcendental world. And so the clothing philosophy is looking at the way for Carlyle this transcendent realm manifests itself in the real world, but also how that manifestation can become no longer an effective expression or manifestation of that transcendental world. Carlyle also, in several texts, Sartor Resartus is one of them, but especially in his text Past and Present, in which he contrasts a vital and living past with a mechanistic dead present, talks about what he calls the Gospels, which represent popular ideology or common beliefs or practices of his time. One of the Gospels that he spends his most time talking about, which he does mention in Sartor, is what he calls the Gospel of Mammonism. And the Gospel of Mammonism refers to primarily the pursuit of self-interest, and self-interest often in the form of money, at the expense of concern for one's fellow human beings. So one is selfishly pursuing one's own self-interest, especially one is pursuing wealth, at the expense of taking care of the people around one, of doing one's duty or working to improve the lot of others. And we'll be looking at a passage from Past and Present in which Carlyle looks at a Scotch widow who has been turned away from several charitable concerns because they can't help her, and she ends up dying of disease in a street and infecting several other people in the street and killing several other people as a result of her neglect. And Carlyle says, is this truly what we owe to our fellow human beings? The next gospel is the Gospel of Dilettantism, and the Gospel of Dilettantism is Carlyle's attack on the aristocracy because they no longer fulfill their function of leading society, but instead are pursuing their own recreational pursuits and enjoying their wealth without taking care of others. The role of a leader is to care for other people and to take care of the people for whom one is responsible, and the aristocracy has abdicated that role and is no longer caring for other people but only pursuing its own concerns, trying to protect its own wealth and engaging in what he calls partridge shooting, idle pursuits as opposed to leading the country. And we'll look later at who the people are that Carlyle believes are fit to lead the country. In both Characteristics and Sartor Resartus, we'll be looking at Carlyle's concept of work and action. Carlyle believes that work or action, doing something, going out and finding something that needs to be done and doing that thing, is the only thing that leads to the improvement of society.
Work and action are the clothing of the transcendental realm. They are the means by which the transcendental realm manifests itself in the actual world.
And work or action is opposed to the inaction of the partridge-shooting aristocracy or the incapability of the church to lead its people. So the people who are actually out doing the work, taking action to improve things, are the people who should lead society. Which leads us to his concept of heroes and hero worship. In a benign sense, This concept is tied to Shelley's notion of the unacknowledged legislators of the world. So it has its roots in Shelley's romanticism, the idea that people who are able to intuit and shadow forth the eternal realm are the people who properly lead society because they enliven it and make it anew. For Carlyle, the concept is that the hero is the person who should actually lead society. We know heroes because they are people who are actively taking on an heroic role. They're actually going out doing something and leading society. For Carlyle, one of the groups that offers promise of effectively leading society are the people he calls the captains of industry. Now, the problem with the captains of industry is that they pursue the gospel of Mammonism. They pursue self-interest and profit over social good. But the advantage of the captains of industry is they're actually out doing something. They're working, they're creating, they're manufacturing. And so if they could be freed from the gospel of Mammonism, they would become effective leaders for society. And so they do actually offer promise. And this is the benign interpretation of Carlyle's definition of heroes. But there's a darker interpretation of heroes and hero worship as well. And that is that for Carlyle, those people who are able to seize and control power are also heroes. And he has great admiration for people like Frederick the Great of Prussia or even Napoleon. He writes two very long histories, one about Frederick the Great and another, the French Revolution, celebrating Napoleon. So the darker side of his notion of heroes and hero worship is that in some ways Carlyle lends himself to being a proto-fascist. That Carlyle sees people who are able to grasp and use power as heroes who are fit to lead society forward, something that George Bernard Shaw would later embody in the Superman, and Nietzsche would call the Übermensch, and ultimately someone like Ayn Rand would endorse as someone who is able to grasp and manifest power, but who frightens many of us because it also leads to fascism and totalitarianism, because as we all know, all power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So although Carlyle's notion of heroes and hero worship has some benign connections with romantic ideology, on the other hand, it also leads itself to those of us who live after World War II and various totalitarian regimes to more frightening consequences. We'll be looking now at Characteristics. Characteristics is an important text to study for Carlyle because although it's his first published essay, he started writing it after he had started writing Sartor Resartus, which was published much later. And although it is ostensibly a review of other written works for publication, it also expresses in a nascent but surprisingly complete form Carlyle's own philosophy. And if you're able to get through Characteristics and understand the basis of his philosophy there, it will be a very useful guide as you approach a more complex text like Sartor Resartus. Now, in Characteristics, he contrasts a series of different kinds of characteristics which he believes characterize, on the one hand, a vital, dynamic, and healthy society with a mechanical, self-conscious, and moribund society. And so for a vital society is unconscious. It simply acts. It doesn't study, but does. Whereas a mechanical society is overwhelmingly self-conscious, constantly paying attention to itself, constantly questioning rather than doing things. An unconscious and vital society is one that is based in spirituality, where it gets its direction from the transcendental realm, whereas a mechanical society is based upon materialism. It's based upon material pleasure and the seeking of material wealth. A vital society is essentially creative. Recalling what Shelley said in his defense of poetry, it is constantly using the intuition of its leaders to intuit the transcendental realm, bring that truth back to the rest of us who then follow. Whereas a mechanical culture is manufactured. It's something that's built rather than created. The vital dynamic culture is ruled by the artist, whereas the mechanical culture is ruled by the debater and the reasoner. And the vital dynamic culture is ruled by intuition,
whereas a mechanical culture is based upon logic and reason, and therefore is caught in a very limited realm. And then finally, a vital dynamic culture is the result of inspiration from this form of intuition, whereas the mechanical culture comes from analysis and is trapped in this constant, recursive, self-conscious self-analysis, which doesn't allow it to accomplish anything at all. So that brings us to his discussion of unconsciousness and unself-consciousness in the essay characteristics. He starts off the essay by saying, "The healthy know not of their health, but only the sick." This is the physician's aphorism, and applicable in a far wider sense than he gives it. Now, in today's health-conscious society, that may not be as true as it was in his time, but the point is that healthy people don't walk around continually thinking, "Ew, my stomach feels amazingly good today." You really are only conscious of your health when you don't feel well, is his point. And he's going to extend this from a discussion of the body to a discussion of the body politic. He says, "We may say it holds no less in moral, intellectual, political, poetical than in merely corporeal therapeutics, that wherever, or in what shape soever, powers of the sort that can be named vital are at work." Powers of the sort which can be named vital are at work. Herein lies the test of their working right or working wrong. In the body, for example, as all doctors are agreed, the first condition of complete health is that each organ perform its function unconsciously, unheeded. Let any organ announce its separate existence, were it even boastfully, and for pleasure, not for pain, then already has one of those unfortunate false centers of sensibility established itself. Already is derangement there. The perfection of bodily well-being is that the collective bodily activities seem one and be manifested, moreover, not in themselves, but in the action that they accomplish. So he's already setting up his notion that self-examination and self-consciousness results in inaction, and unconsciousness is a precondition of action, because if we don't feel well, we're constantly focusing on not feeling well. When we feel well, we're able to act. In fact, unity, agreement, is always silent or soft-voiced. It is only discord that loudly proclaims itself. So long as the several elements of life, all fitly adjusted, can pour forth their movement like harmonious tuned strings, it is melody in unison. So let's skip down just a bit to the bottom of this column. He says that what is true of bodily health is also true of spiritual health. Of the soul with her activities, we shall find it no less true than of the body. "Nay," cried the spiritualist, "is not that very division of the unity man into dualism and soul and body itself the symptom of his disease, as perhaps your frightful theory of materialism, of his being but a body, and therefore at least once more unity, may be the paroxysm which was critical in the beginning of the cure?" And so the idea here is that the dualistic split of humans into mind and body is already a problem.
A divided body, especially a body that is not driven by the soul and therefore by the transcendental realm, is unable to act.
But then it's compounded by the theory of materialism, which eliminates the soul altogether and says that humans are nothing but a material body. Although he recognizes that perhaps this was at least an attempt at trying to find some sort of solution. But omitting this, we observe with confidence enough that the truly strong mind, viewed as intellect, as morality, or under any other aspect, is nowise the mind acquainted with its strength. That here as before, the sign of health is unconsciousness. In our inward, as in our outward world, what is mechanical lies open to us, not what is dynamical and has vitality. Of our thinking, we may say, it is but the mere upper surface that we shape into articulate thoughts. Underneath the region of argument and conscious discourse lies the region of meditation. Here, in its quiet, mysterious depths, dwell what vital force is in us. Here, if aught is to be created and not merely manufactured and communicated, the work must go on. Manufacture is intelligible, but trivial. Creation is great and cannot be understood. Thus, if the debater and demonstrator, who we may rank as the lowest of true thinkers, knows what he has done and how he did it, the artist, whom we rank as the highest, knows not, and must speak of inspiration, and in one or the other dialect call his work the gift of divinity. And so that will take us back to the chart that we were looking at earlier, and Carlyle setting up this contrast between a dynamical, vital world, which is made up of unconsciousness and creation by the artist, and the mechanical world, which is made up of manufacture and reasoning and debating. In the next section, he argues that the great geniuses are never aware of their genius, that Shakespeare was unconscious of his power and therefore thought it was nothing, and Milton was more conscious and therefore was less great. But I want to skip down to the bottom of this paragraph. He says, "But indeed, as in the higher case of the poet, so here in that of the speaker and the inquirer, the true force is an unconscious one. The healthy understanding, we should say, is not logical argumentative, but the intuitive." So he's contrasting logical with intuition. "For the end of understanding is not to prove and find reasons, but to know and believe. Of logic and its limits and uses and abuses, there were much to be said and examined. One fact, however, which chiefly concerns us here has long been familiar, that the man of logic and the man of insight, the reasoner and the discoverer, or even the knower, are quite separable, indeed for the most part, quite separate characters. In practical matters, for example, has it not become almost proverbial that a man of logic cannot prosper? This is he whom business people call systematic and theorizer and wordmonger. His vital intellectual force lies dormant or extinct. His whole force is mechanical, conscious. Of such a one it is foreseen that, when once confronted with the infinite complexities of the real world, his little compact theorem of the world will be found wanting, that unless he can throw it overboard and become a new creature, he will necessarily founder." So once again, we have the vital intellectual force contrasted with the mechanical and conscious inferior power, and that the infinite complexities of the real world don't fit into the simplistic theories of the reasoner, according to Carlyle.
And once again, you can go back to Shelley's Defense of Poetry and look at the first page where he talks about the difference between poetic inspiration and the operations of reason and the superiority of poetic inspiration.
And this brings us to his discussion in this review of what is currently wrong with his society. If we skip down to the middle of the next column, he says, right here, "Never since the beginning of time was there that we have heard or read of so intensely self-conscious a society. Our whole relations to the universe and to our fellow man have become an inquiry, a doubt. Nothing will go on of its own accord and do its function quietly, but all things must be probed into, the whole working of man's world be anatomically studied, alas, anatomically studied, that it may be medically studied, that it may be medically aided. Till at length, indeed, we have come to such a pass that except in the same medicine with its artifices and appliances, few can so much as imagine any strength or hope to remain for us." And he goes on to complain about the various useless social programs that are attempting to remedy a society, but are in fact, he says, a symptom of the problem. Skip down slightly on page 2 to this in the second column to the bottom of the first full paragraph, but he says, "But alas, with us the spiritual condition of society is no less sickly than the physical. Examine man's internal world and any of its social relations and performances, here too all seems diseased self-consciousness, collision and mutually destructive struggle. Nothing acts from within outwards in undivided healthy force. Everything lies impotent, lamed, its force turned inwards, and painfully listens to itself." And then he goes on to talk about how religion has become not a guide to action, but rather simply a study of religion. He says, "What is the nature of that same religion which still lingers in the hearts of the few who are called and call themselves specially the religious? Is it a healthy religion, vital, unconscious of itself, that shines forth spontaneously in doing of the work, or even in preaching of the word? Unhappily, no. Instead of heroic martyr conduct and inspired and soul-inspiring eloquence whereby religion itself were brought home to our living bosoms to live and reign there, we have discourses on the evidences, endeavoring with smallest result to make it probable that such a thing as religion exists. The most enthusiastic evangelicals do not preach gospel, but keep describing how it should and might be preached to awaken the sacred fire of faith as by a sacred contagion is not their endeavor, but at most to describe how faith shows and acts and scientifically distinguish true faith from false. Religion, like all else, is conscious of itself, listens to itself, It has become less creative, vital, more and more mechanical. Less creative, vital, more mechanical. Considering as a whole, the Christian religion of late ages has been continually dissipating itself into metaphysics and threatens now to disappear as some rivers do in deserts of barren sand. And then he goes on to literature. Of literature and its deep-seated widespread maladies, why speak? Literature is but a branch of religion and always participates in its character. However, in our time, it is the only branch that still shows any greenness, and some think must one day become the main stem, which is something, by the way, Matthew Arnold will argue later. However, Carlyle is going to go on to argue that literature has itself become self-conscious and focuses on studying itself. Nay, is not the diseased self-conscious state of literature disclosed in this one fact, which lies so near us here, the prevalence of reviewing? Carlyle is writing an essay, which is a review, but in the review he's complaining about the practice of reviewing rather than producing. He says, if we skip down, by and by it will be found that all literature has become one boundless, self-devouring review, and as in London routs, we have to do nothing but only see others do nothing. A rout is a social gathering where people show up to watch people. So basically it's something like the pump room in Jane Austen's Northanger Abbey. Thus does literature itself, like a sick thing, superabundantly listen to itself. And then he goes on to talk about philosophy. Philosophy in its very nature is meditative self-study. But he says, no less is this unhealthy symptom manifest if we cast a glance on our philosophy, on the character of our speculative thinking. Nay, already, as above hinted, the mere existence and necessity of a philosophy is an evil. Here's an important line. Man is sent hither not to question, but to work. The end of man, it was long ago written, is an action, not a thought. This will be something that you'll hear again, repeated prominently in Sartor Resartus. In the perfect state, all thought were but the picture and inspiring symbol of action. Philosophy, except as poetry and religion, would have no being. And yet how, in this imperfect state, can it be avoided? Can it be dispensed with? And so the problem, of course, here, according to Carlyle, is that we live in all this uncertainty, and so we turn to philosophy as a way of getting ourselves out, which means that it is a symptom of the problem. Rather than finding a way to take action to solve the problem, we're simply constantly and recursively studying the problem. What we need to rely on instead is action and work. And if you skip down to the bottom, he talks about the fact that we live in this huge, mysterious, transcendental realm. And the only way to manifest the transcendental into the world is through action. We, the whole species of mankind and our whole existence and history, are but a floating speck in the illimitable ocean of the all. Yet in that ocean, indissoluble portion thereof, partaking of its infinite tendencies, borne this way and that by its deep swelling tides and grand ocean currents, of which what fatest chances are that we should ever exhaust the significance, ascertain the goings and comings. A region of doubt, therefore, hovers forever in the background. In action alone can we have certainty. Nay, properly, doubt is the indispensable, inexhaustible material whereon action works, which action has to fashion into certainty and reality. Only on the canvas of darkness, such as man's way of being, could the many-colored picture of our life paint itself in shine. So this is the philosophy of work that Carlyle will bring up at the end of the everlasting yea in Sartor Resartus. In the next section, he foreshadows his discussion in past and present by describing the difference between the philosophical inaction of current time and the past time when there was plenty of room for heroic action. If you slide down just a bit, he says, the problem now is that there is no place for young humans to engage in action. For young valor and the thirst of action, no ideal chivalry invites to heroism, prescribes what is heroic. The old ideal of manhood has grown obsolete, and the new is still invisible to us, and we grope after it in darkness, one clutching this phantom, another that. Verdurism, Byralism, and even Brummelism. Carlyle loves his isms, and he's constantly making up isms. Verdurism is sensibility. It's referring to the Goethe's novel, The Sorrows of Young Werther. Byronism is, of course, referring to Lord Byron and his cynical, dispassionate separation. Brummelism is referring to Beau Brummel, who was a famous dandy in Regency times, and Brummelism is simply putting on the appearance of good deportment rather than actually being a good person. Each has its day. For contemplation and love of wisdom, no cloister now opens its religious shades. The thinker must, in all senses, wander homeless, too often aimless, looking up at a heaven which is dead to him, and round to an earth which is deaf. Remember that Carlyle is writing Characteristics at the same time that he's writing Sartor Resartus, and so clearly he's thinking of Diogenes Teufelsdreck at this particular point, who is the thinker wandering homeless and aimless, looking for some sort of truth. And this clearly calls our attention to the everlasting no. Action in those old days was easy, was voluntary, for the divine worth of human beings lay acknowledged. Speculation was wholesome, for it ranged itself as the handmaid of action. What could not so range itself died out by its natural death, by neglect. Loyalty still hallowed obedience and made rule noble. There was something to be loyal to. The godlike stood embodied under many a symbol of man's interest in business. The finite shadowed forth the infinite. Eternity looked through time. The life of man was encompassed and over-canopied by the glory of heaven, even as his dwelling place by the azure vault. How changed in these new days! Truly may it be said, the divinity is withdrawn from the earth, or veils himself in wide wasting whirlwind of parting era, wherein the fewest can discern his goings. Not Godhead, but an iron, ignoble circle of necessity embraces all things, binds the youth of these times into a sluggish thrall, or else exasperates him into a rebel. Heroic action is paralyzed, for what worth now remains unquestionable with him? Aye, the fervid period wherein his whole nature cries aloud for action, there is nothing sacred under whose banner he can act. The course and kind of his conditions of free action are all but undiscoverable. Doubt storms in on him through every avenue. Inquiries of the deepest, painfulest sort must be engaged with, and the invincible energy of young years waste itself in skeptical, suicidal cavilings, in passionate questionings of destiny, whereto no answer will be returned.
Again, Carlyle seems to be looking at Teufelsdreck and his problems during the everlasting no and the center of indifference and the everlasting yea. However, he's also describing his belief that in a time of overwhelming doubt, with no clear guidance from any of the institutions that usually provide an explanation of the metaphysical realm, such as religion, that it's very difficult for a young person who wants to do something to know what it is they should do.
In the next section, he says, at least those people who are working to fill their hungry bellies have a purpose, and so in that sense, at least they're happy. These men have an aim, such as it is, and can steer towards it with chagrin enough truly, yet as their hands are kept full without desperation. Unhappier are they to whom a higher instinct has been given, who struggle to be persons, not machines, to whom the universe is not a warehouse, or at least a fancy bazaar, but a mystic temple and hall of doom. For such men lie properly two courses open. The lower, yet still inestimable class take up with worn-out symbols of the godlike, that is, they persist in believing in outdated religion, keep trimming and trucking between these and hypocrisy, purblindly enough, miserably enough. Another group, a numerous intermediate class, end in denial and form a theory that there is no theory, that nothing is certain in the world except this fact of pleasure being pleasant, and they try to realize what trifling modicum of pleasure they can come at and to live contented therewith, winking hard. These would be the utilitarians. Of those we speak not here, but only of the second nobler class, who also have dared to say no and cannot say yea, but feel that in the no they dwell as in a Golgotha, where life enters not, where peace is not appointed them.
Golgotha, of course, is the place of the skull. In Christian religion, it's the traditional site of Jesus' crucifixion, a place of desolate hopelessness.
And according to Carlyle, these people who dwell in this Golgotha, this center of indifference, are constantly striving for something greater but don't know where to find it. And so all they do is whine and complain. And he talks about Byron and Shelley among those.
In his essay Characteristics, Carlyle is showing that he believes a healthy, vital society is one in which there is a clear path for action. The problem that his society faces is that the traditional means of determining how one should act have become lost. The church is no longer providing clear religious direction. It's either populated by the younger sons of the gentry who are spending their time and money shooting partridges, or it is engaging in research into discovering the meaning of religion rather than giving direction.
And the aristocracy has become lost in self-interested pursuit of pleasure. And so it has become very difficult to find a means to know what to do. Carlyle himself, as we'll see in Sartor Resartus, is happy to provide direction for how people should behave.